Really excited to be here. I've always wanted to visit. So I need to thank IIT Guwahati, TechNiche 2017, and the entire organizing team who got me here. They really went the extra mile to make sure I got here and made it here safely and comfortably. So actually, can you bring up the house lights just a little bit, real quick? House lights? Anybody? There we go. Okay, I'm gonna do a selfie real quick with you guys. And then I'm gonna ask for your help in something. All right, so now, all right, everybody raise your hand like you're gonna ask a question, okay? Hey, hold on. Okay. And now, hold on. I'm going to count to three. Raise your hand again. Everybody raise your hand. I'm going to count to three. And when I say three, you say, when is Half-Life 3? Okay? All right? Ready? Raise your hand. One, two, three.
When is Half-Life 3?
Awesome. Make you dinner. When they start out, they have an idea in their mind of what your experience is going to be like when you eat, right? So already the product isn't what you normally think of. When you're thinking of like a cook is going to make dinner, it's going to be an object that sits on a plate and you look at it, maybe it's pretty, it smells good, but really the end goal is the eating of the food, right? So already you've got it, the process starts all the way back in the cook's mind and ends when you consume the food. And everything in between is one thing. It's not two separate things. It's not the process and the product. The process is the product. The entire, from this end to that end, is the product. And as you know, like some people cook with a recipe, right? So there's a structure. Some people make it up as they go. So already there's choice there that can happen that can completely influence what's going to come out the back end based on the front end. And then let's say you are using a recipe. People have choices like, you know, exactly what is a tablespoon of salt? You know, some people a little more, some people a little less. Maybe they do it with their fingers because they have their own sense of what that means to put some salt in there. So even though you have a structure, a recipe, that person is gonna make a different dish than somebody else. And then you have the intangible process, the hidden secret process, which is, I don't know if you've seen, there's a movie called like Water for Chocolate, and it's all about the love that is felt while you cook, right? And of course you could probably break that down so that it's like if somebody's loving the people they're cooking for, they're gonna pay more attention to the food and the way it tastes and make it extra good. But maybe it's all these intangible, lots of little details and complex data that actually makes up that dish. And then of course, the setting and the way it's served. And then, are you hungry? That's a famous French quote, like hunger makes the best sauce. So if you're really hungry, oh, it's gonna taste so good. And if you're in love with the cook, all the better, right? So that's the idea, is that it's one continuum. Let's see. So this is something I like to think about sometimes, and this is sort of a look at process. So over here on the left, you have the beginning, and you know the completion is your blue line, how much you've gotten done. And the yellow are the possibilities of what you can do. So at the beginning, you haven't gotten anything done. Zero done, and everything's possible, right? There's nothing that's not possible at that point because you haven't done anything. You haven't eliminated any possibilities in the process. But as you go, in this case, it's a linear inverse, right? Like, as you go, more things get done, less things become possible, and by the end, you have the thing, which is kind of like something, but it's actually the thing, it's the end. And nothing's possible. Well, everything, like, I wanted to be a novelist, I think, was the first thing. A comic book artist, a magician. I did that, I was really into that for a while. You know, all kinds of stuff, but they were all basically around the arts. And so it's sort of how I've spent my life. I've always been pretty obsessed with process. You know, a lot of times people will call me a technical artist, and that's not untrue, but I'm also, on the one hand, I'm really obsessed with the process of production and the techniques and the technical components of that. I'm also really obsessed with that actorly version too, which is the undefinable sort of hidden process that goes on. And the truth is all art throughout all history has been, other than singing is a special one, has been connected to some form of technology, whether it was, you know, crushing pigments to make your paint, that's technology, right? Guitar or violin, any step or progress in technology has always superseded or preceded new forms of art, without fail. So I started young. I was not by any means a prodigy or anything. I just happened to be really interested in the arts really young. Oh, and here's the other thing. You guys are all, I assume most of you, are, I guess, what we call digital natives, right? So you would have had the internet pretty much your whole life. I am not, by any stretch. You know, I'm 53 years old, so I pretty much grew up in the late 60s, 70s. And while there were computers and I was exposed to them, they weren't a part of my life to any really strong degree until probably the mid 80s. However, so our generation, I think Brooks is a similar age, we're sort of one generation under the Bill Gateses and, you know, the Bill Wozniaks and whatnot who invented computers. So we're almost kind of generation zero when it comes to computers and art. Like, I have had access to computers when they made a big difference to how I did my art and how I was able to accomplish my art. And so I think by going through this life story, you'll get to a little bit of a history, you know, not a deep one, but a little bit of a history lesson that you otherwise probably wouldn't be familiar with. I think there's a really big difference between the fact that you have probably had a smartphone for a lot of years and what those applications mean versus those of us who, you know, would run an application with a command line and it would take 5 minutes to load up. Right? That was a really different era and it had a really different meaning to the process of art early on. So the thing I'm going to focus on is temporal arts, which is what I do for the most part. I do draw, but I'm not very good at it and it's not really what I focus on. By temporal arts, I mean the design of things that happen over time, right? Even story in film is a temporal art because you're basically communicating symbols or events over time that add up to a story or an idea. Music is clearly temporal art. I don't mean Jackson Pollock, who is temporal while he's making his art. You know, he's throwing the paint down and splashing it around and kicking it or whatever. Because at the end of the day, he's making a static painting. And yes, the consumption of that painting is a time, you're consuming it through time, but it wasn't designed, like the moments of time that you consume it, while through his symmetry or whatever, he might have guided you loosely, it's not a time-based form, right? So that's what I've focused on my whole life and what we're gonna talk about pretty much today, if you kind of include programming in that. Art versus craft and science. This is something that I've thought about quite a bit. I don't know, because I think too much. That's not what I wanted to do. The way I personally define art versus craft, and I know it's the classic, like, what is art, you know? But for me, the gist of art is it's an expression of a person. It's a person trying to be unique. It's trying to say, I am a unique being in the universe. Here's my art. They don't have to think that, but that's sort of the gist of it. Whereas craft is the technique, the process they use to achieve the ends, the artistic outcome, right? They're not mutually exclusive. A lot of times, most times, art is going to use some form of craft to achieve its end. But you can have craft that is devoid of art, right? Like, it's entirely possible. Commercial art is often that case, I think. Sometimes